Everybody, are you back after the short break? Can you hear me and see the presentation?
Yes, sir. We can hear and see.
Okay, so let's make it full screen. Okay, any questions before we continue? Okay, no questions. Okay, property tables. Okay. Now, ideally, it is very convenient to have some simple relations. Okay, you plug in the values and do some calculation and get the result, like the ideal gas equation of state. Okay. But unfortunately, for the substances that we encounter in practice, other than when they behave as an ideal gas, there are no simple relations for among the properties. Therefore, we have to list them. In practice, of course, instead of looking up tables, we have the programs that when you enter, let's say, two properties, you can just get automatically other properties. That is, all the calculations are done automatically. But if you do simple calculations, then you need the property tables in order to get the properties there. Therefore, in the appendix of the textbook, we have a lot of tables, okay? And we will learn how to use today at least some of them, not all of them. Let's say table one has the properties of, you know, gas constant, molar mass, critical point properties, okay? And then table two, ideal gas specific heats. Table three, properties of common liquids, solids, foods. We will start that. You can also find these in physics books, many of them. For the pure substances, phase change processes, thermodynamic properties, we will start with chapter four. It is a saturated water temperature table, pressure, superheated, compressed, whatever. Okay. So the tables are 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. These are seven tables. They are in the diagram, Moliere diagram. They are related to, and TS diagram, to water. And then tables 11, 12, 13, 14, they are related to the refrigerant that we will use, refrigerant 134A. And then we will also use the generalized compressibility chart in the last section of this chapter. The properties of the atmosphere at high altitude, like the pressure there, you may need some values sometimes, but not much. So today we will deal with tables 1 through 15, okay? And we will see how it is done. But first, let's define a new property. We will discuss the details in the next chapter. Often we run into the combination of internal energy, okay, and PV, which is, you can call, like the flow of energy associated with the pressure there, or P over rho, okay, and same thing. Instead of this, you may have like P over rho. That is U plus PV. Since we encounter this so often during the flow systems, like you have a control volume, some fluid entering, some fluid leaving. Now the energy of the fluid, the internal energy is U1, and the flow of energy is P1, V1. Instead of, you know, just considering them separately and making this calculation P times V, what we do is, we do this once, okay, U plus PV, and we define it as a new property enthalpy for convenience. Therefore, U plus PV is enthalpy. That's simple, okay? And you will see that when you analyze control volumes, this helps a lot. Then you don't have to deal with the work associated to push a fluid in or to push a fluid out, okay, the flow work it is called. We just use enthalpy to represent the energy of the fluid. Whereas for rigid tanks, okay, or piston cylinder devices, to represent the energy, we just use U, internal energy. So flow systems, these are the flow systems versus non-flow systems. So for flow systems, the H represents the enthalpy there. For non-flow ones, U, internal energy, represents the energy of the fluid. This, of course, involves, let's say, this is per unit mass, kilojoule per kilogram, and this is total kilojoule. Now, U, the unit is kilojoule per kilogram, right? I mean, no, just kilojoule. Then PV, what do you think the unit of PV must be? Anybody? The unit of U is internal energy, kilojoule. Then what do you think the unit of P times V must be? Do I hear kilojoule also? It must be that way. Otherwise, it is the equation is not dimensionally homogeneous, right? You cannot add apples and oranges, okay? It has to have the same unit. So here, you can see the summary. Kilopascal cubic meter is equivalent to kilojoule, okay? And kilopascal cubic meter per kilogram is kilojoule per kilogram. Bar cubic meter, remember that one bar is 100 kilopascal, okay? Therefore, it is 100 kilojoule. Megapascal cubic meter is 1000 kilojoule, and this is the old British units there. So we make sure that we have unit consistency there in case we ever do the calculation. Some more terminology. Now, you know what specific volume is, and V is the symbol for specific volume, V of this shape. Now, to show saturated liquid, we use the subscript F, okay? So it is a specific volume of saturated liquid. And then to denote a saturated vapor, these are from German, we use the symbol G, okay? So it is a specific volume of VG, saturated vapor, okay? And to show the difference between a gas property and liquid property, or saturated vapor, saturated liquid difference, we use the subscript FG. It simply means difference between G property and F property. For example, VFG is VG minus VF, okay? In table 4, we have saturation properties of water listed under temperature, okay? So here we have temperature. And in table 5, the following paper, we again have the saturation properties of water, but this time under pressure. So these two columns, okay, they change places. Then you have neat pressure values there. So this is the temperature in table 4. This is the corresponding saturation pressure. As you see here, saturation pressure, okay, P saturation. Specific volume, in this case, we need to know the specific volume of the liquid and vapor. So we list, we have two columns there, VF and VG, okay. And it continues. Let me show you the tables. Let's say this is table 4. I just copied from there. So the first column is temperature, okay, for water. This is saturated water temperature table. Okay, the next one, saturated water pressure table, table 5. So let's go back here. So the only difference is the first column. Table 4, it is listed, properties are listed under temperature. So that we have neat values here, like 5, 10, 15, 20. And but for pressures, we have like 0.87, 1.22, 1.7, you know, whatever. And they are not neat. What if, let's say, you need a neat pressures, like 200 kilopascal or 10 megapascal, then you go to pressure right here. Properties are listed under neat values of pressure. Okay, like 1, 2, 20, 50, you know, 200, whatever. And this time the temperatures are not so neat. Let's say at 100, we have like 99.61, whatever. So if let's say you need properties against pressure, because a pressure is given, then you use table 5. But if you need properties against a temperature, for a given temperature, then you need to use table 4. But the information given is exactly the same, okay? Now, what other information is given here? So specific volume, as you see here, this is the liquid, this is the vapor. Then internal energy, the symbol is U. So this is of the saturated liquid and saturated vapor. And this is the difference to make the calculations easy. And then enthalpy, again, this is for the liquid, HF. This is for the vapor, HG. And the difference is HFG, as you see here. And then entropy, don't worry about the entropy now. We will go through it in chapter 6, okay? Or 7. And this is the pressure one, okay? Now, the best way to learn is to go through the examples. Example, problem. We have a rigid tank. And when we say rigid, what does it mean? The volume is what? Constant, right? It contains 50 kilograms of saturated liquid water at 90 degrees. And the question is, determine the pressure in the tank and the volume of the tank. So what is given? We have this tank. The temperature is 90 degrees, and it is filled with saturated liquid. Okay. Now, what is the logical approach here? First of all, anytime you see the word saturation, saturated liquid, saturated vapor, saturated liquid vapor mixture, okay, that means you are under this dome or on the curve here. So obviously, since we have liquid, we have on this part of the curve, and it is 90 degrees, so we are right here. So this is the state, which means I have F properties, like VF, UF, HF, whatever, okay? I have the F properties there. And since it is on this curve or in between, the pressure must be saturation pressure corresponding to this temperature, okay? So, since saturation conditions exist in the tank, the pressure must be saturation pressure at 90 degrees. And how do we find it? 90 given. Are we gonna go to table 4 or 5? Anybody? Okay, waiting for an answer. Table 4 or 5? I can't hear you. Okay, obviously table 4, it is given here, right? So how do we do it? Okay, we find 90 degrees, which is right here, 90, okay? And then we simply read the pressure next to it, which is 70.183. So the pressure must be this one here, okay? If you have saturated liquid, saturated vapor, or saturated mixture, and if you know the temperature, then the pressure must be the saturation pressure corresponding to it. Okay? So this answers one of the questions. The other question, the volume of the tank. Okay, I know the mass. Okay, I know the mass. Now, mass is density times volume, right? Or density is the inverse of specific volume. So it is total volume divided by specific volume. Or total volume is, as you see here, mass times specific volume. Okay, I know the mass. I need the specific volume. Since I have saturated liquid, the specific volume must be VF. Okay. So what do? I go to the table. Again, 90 degrees. I look here. Okay, this is the column for VF. So I come down here. I find 90. So I just read from here. Okay, 0.001036. I use it here, multiply, and I get the result. So this is the total volume of the tank. Okay, any questions on this example? Very simple, but very important. No questions. Okay, then let's do another example. This time we have saturated vapor in a cylinder. Okay, and the volume is given. The piston cylinder device contains 0.06 cubic meter of saturated vapor. Again, we read the problem carefully. Saturated water vapor. Okay. First, it is water, and then it is vapor, and then the vapor is saturated. It is not superheated vapor. And pressure is given. Okay. Determine the temperature and the mass of the vapor inside the cylinder. So, on a PV diagram or TV, doesn't matter. This is the saturation curve. Therefore, I have saturated vapor, so I must be somewhere on this curve, saturated vapor line, okay? And underneath, I have the volume value, which must be Vg, okay? Then, since I have a saturation state and the pressure is given, what do you think the temperature should be? Temperature must be the saturation temperature at the given pressure. And I need to go to which table? Table 4 or 5. Since pressure is given, I go to table 5, okay? Because this is where I can find the nice value for pressure. It is 350, so right here, 350 kilopascal. Okay, what do I need here? The temperature. It is the value next to it. 138.86. Okay, degrees C. And then specific volume, again, same way. I have saturated vapor, Vg. So I simply go down to the same line. I read Vg corresponding to 350 kilopascal. Okay, plug it in here. This is the total volume. So this is the mass. Any questions so far on this example? Okay, no question. All right. Let's add some complication, but still simple. We have 200 grams of saturated liquid water. It is completely vaporized at constant pressure of 100 kilopascal. And the question is, what is the volume change? And what is the amount of energy transferred to the water for this phase change to occur? Okay. So what is given? Pressure and the process. If you plot the process curve, again, this is the saturation dome, the green one. Initial state is saturated liquid right here. Final state is saturated vapor right there. Okay. Then obviously at 100 kilopascal, my initial specific volume will be Vf and my final specific volume will be Vg. And the energy needed is enthalpy change. Here it is Hf. And here it is Hg, okay, right here. That means, again, pressure is given. I need to go to pressure table, which is what? Table 5. And the pressure is 100 right here. Okay. So I need to read the values at 100 kilopascal. So you simply read, you know, the values in that line, okay? You can, let's say, see, read Vf and Vg from here, and then Hf on the same line, and Hg from there. In fact, you don't need to read Hf and Hg because the difference is given right here, okay? Right here. Okay, VGVF, the volume change is this, per unit volume, per unit mass right here. And then the total mass is 0.2 kilogram. So if you multiply, this is the volume change, delta V. And the energy needed is, we will do those in detail in the next chapter, mass times HFG, this is HFG, and this is mass. So that is the energy needed to vaporize 0.2 kilogram of saturated liquid into saturated vapor. Questions here? No? Okay, now what if we have a mixture that is some liquid and some vapor? Let's say we have a system like this. We have some liquid and some vapor. Okay. In this case, for convenience, we define a new property. See, we are learning a lot of words. Quality. Quality. Okay. Which is X as the ratio of the mass of vapor to total mass. Okay. Therefore, quality is the quality is the fraction. In fact, mass fraction of vapor in the mixture. Or you can say the ratio of the mass of the vapor to the total mass. Same thing, right? Okay. Now, can we relate quality to other properties? Yes, we can. Okay, now let's say this is what we have, a saturated vapor and liquid mixture, okay? Now let's imagine you shake it well, you have a homogeneous mixture like this, so that the average specific volume is V average. Now the question is, can we express this V average in terms of Vf, Vg, and the quality X? So that if you know quality, we can just determine the average volume, or if you know average volume and temperature pressure, we can calculate the quantity. Okay, let's have a logical approach. Let's say the total volume of this tank is capital V, okay? And the volume of this part is capital G, okay? Let me see. Okay. Okay. We are back to full screen. This part is VF. Doesn't like it when I write at the top. Okay. Let me see. Okay. And this part is capital V G. What is the total volume? Total volume. The volume of the liquid and the volume of the vapor. Sure. Total volume is...
Sorry for interrupting. We can't see
it. You can see it?
I can't see the screen.
Okay. It looks like when I wrote, I canceled the screen sharing there. Okay, let's do it again. Okay, now you can see the presentation PowerPoint?
Yes, we do.
Okay. Now, total volume is total mass times the average volume. Now, this is the average volume. We assume like they are, you know, mixed on the right here. Okay. And volume of the liquid is mass of liquid times specific volume of liquid. Volume of the vapor is mass of vapor times specific volume of vapor. Okay. And since MF is total mass times minus MG, okay, replace that MF by this one. Okay. And then divide this expression by M total, everything. So this will cancel, okay? And you will get the average. This will be M total divided by M total, one. And then M vapor divided by M total is X, okay? Quality, VF. And then this is also X, VG. So we get, you know, this relation here. If you rearrange it, okay. Therefore, quality is this relation here. It is like V average minus V liquid divided by V FG, the difference between the two. Similarly, you can show that U average is UF plus X UFG, H average is HF plus X HFG, and this can be any property, really, okay? So this is the relation we have for quality. Keep in mind that quality has meaning only in this region, in the saturated liquid plus vapor region. If you have compressed liquid or superheated vapor, what is the quality? It is meaningless, okay? So it has meaning only between saturated liquid and saturated vapor there in this region. Therefore, that V, the V average, must be between VF and VG. Same way, U, internal energy, average, must be between UF and UG. Okay? Now, Let's show how it is used in an example here. Now we have a rigid tank. Contains 10 kilograms of water at 90 degrees. 8 kilogram is in the liquid form, the rest in vapor. Question, what is the pressure? And what is the volume of the tank? Okay. Now, some observations. If let's say you have liquid vapor mixture, that is some liquid and some vapor in equilibrium, then you have saturated liquid vapor mixture. So you are, your state is under this saturation curve, somewhere in here, okay? The temperature is given to be 90, okay? On a TV diagram or PV diagram, it will look the same. So you have this horizontal line and your state is right here. It is not completely liquid, not completely vapor. It is in between. It is partially liquid. Okay. So how do you approach this problem? Since we are in the saturated region, okay, and the temperature is given, the pressure must be saturation pressure at the given temperature. So what do we do? We are given the 90 degrees. We go to the temperature saturation table, which is table 4. Okay. The temperature is 90 degrees right here. And we read the pressure, which is 70 something. So here it is. It must be that value. And then at 90 degrees, we can also read Vf, as you see here, and Vg, the specific volumes of saturated liquid and saturated vapor. And then we know that total volume is the volume of liquid and vapor, okay? And volume is mass times specific volume. So we have this relation here. Plug in values, liquid volume mass is 8 kilogram. Liquid specific volume is this. Mass of vapor is 2 kilogram. And then specific volume is that. Do the calculations there, you end up with this, which means the total volume of the tank is 4.73 cubic meters. And what is quality? By definition, quality is the mass of vapor divided by total mass. So it is 0.2. Okay. Any questions on this one? Okay, no question. And also the we can also do it a different way. You can go through that one at home. That is, find the quality first, for example, and then use this relation. V is Vf plus X Vfg. Use the same values and you get the same result. Okay. Now, this is also using the properties of saturated liquid and saturated vapor. But this time we have a refrigerant. Refrigerant 134A instead of liquid water, okay? And the pressure is 160 kilopascal. The pressure is given. The mass is given. And the question is, what is the temperature, quality, enthalpy, and the volume occupied by the vapor phase? Okay. Now, in this case, are we in the compressed liquid region, saturated region, a mixture, or superheated region? We don't know. Because what is given is the mass, the volume, and the pressure. Okay. Therefore, we have to know the region first so that we can use the proper table. And the way to do it is, since we know the total volume and total mass, we can calculate the specific volume, okay, which is 0.02. And we know that if the volume is less than Vf, it will be compressed liquid. If it is greater than Vg, it will be superheated vapor. Okay, right here. Therefore, at the given pressure, I read Vf and Vg values. So I go to the refrigerant table, table 11. Okay. I find the pressure 160. Okay. Right here, 160. The pressure table. Okay. First of all, it looks like the temperature is minus 15.6. Okay, the next value here. And then I can read Vf and Vg if it is a mixture. Okay, copy those values from there and then compare this 0.02, okay, with these values. What do you notice? 0.02 is between the two. So this is Vf, this is Vf, this is Vg. My volume is in between. Okay, greater than Vf, less than Vg. Therefore, I must have saturated mixture. Okay, and since I must have saturated mixture, the temperature must be saturation temperature. So this is what I read right here. And then quality I can calculate from this relation. And if I know quality, I can calculate enthalpy from that relation by reading HF and HFG. This is HF right here, and this is HFG. And this is how I calculate the enthalpy of the mixture there. Okay. And the mass of the vapor, the total mass is this one, 4 kilogram. The quality, which is the fraction of vapor mass, is 15.7%. So this is the mass of the vapor. And the volume occupied by vapor, it is m times v. We know the mass of the vapor, the specific volume of the vapor. So this is the total volume occupied by vapor. Okay. Any questions on this one? Okay, no questions. So let's continue. Superheated vapor. So now we are done with this, you know, under the dome, saturated liquid, saturated vapor, or the air mixture. What if, let's say, we have superheated vapor? Now, first of all, superheated vapor, if a temperature is given, the pressure is lower. And if pressure is given, temperature is higher. And if volume is given, it is greater than Vg. Internal energy is greater than saturated vapor value. Enthalpy greater than saturated vapor value at a given pressure and temperature. Okay, so we keep that in mind. And this time we don't have Uf, Ug or Vf, Vg, because we don't have two phases, we have a single phase. So as you see, we just have V, U, H, whatever. Okay. And in the superheated vapor region, the pressure and temperature, they are independent. When the temperature is given, pressure doesn't have to be a certain value. Therefore, we list the properties against temperature and pressure. Okay. Example, what is the internal energy of water at 200 kilopascal pressure and 300 degrees C temperature? Okay. Now this time, what we can do is we go to the saturation pressure table. Okay, 200 kilopascal. Okay, let's do it. Okay, this is the refrigerant. Okay, 200 kilopascal right here. What is the corresponding temperature? 120. Okay. And our given temperature is So the saturation temperature is 120. But our temperature is 300. So our T is greater than T saturation, which means we have superheated vapor. Okay. Therefore, we have to go to the superheated vapor table. And 200 kilopascal is 0.2 megapascal. So in the table, we check 0.2, oh, right here, 0.2 megapascal. And this is the saturation temperature anyway, so you don't need to go to another table. You can just read the saturation temperature there. And what is the temperature? 300, okay. So here it is, 300. What is it asking? Internal energy, U, so it is a this column. That means just this value here, okay? 2800 something right here. So this is how you read the superheated vapor table, okay? And if let's say H is given and temperature, okay? Then again, at the given temperature, I mean, let's say pressure, for example, you determine HF and HG and compare the given H value. If it is greater than HG, then you have superheated vapor, okay? And you may need to do interpolation there. And the third lecture will be done by Mehmet Can, the assistant, and he can also show you the to do some interpolation if necessary. Okay, now compressed liquid, finally, in that case, just opposite of superheated vapor, okay? The pressures are higher for a given temperature. The temperatures are lower for a given pressure. Specific volume, lower. Internal energy, enthalpy are lower, okay? And often we use this approximation. We could treat the compressed liquid as approximately saturated liquid at the given temperature. This is a common approximation. If you don't have the compressed liquid table, okay, then you can use this approximation there. So for the volume, internal energy, and enthalpy, okay? An example, we have compressed liquid water at 80 degrees and 5 megapascal. It says using the data of the compressed liquid table and saturated liquid approximation, determine the internal energy and also determine the error involved in the approximation. Okay, we have pressure and temperature. So this is just like superheated vapor, but we go to compressed liquid tables, okay? For water, which is table 7, right after the superheated vapor. The pressure is 5 megapascal, so right here. The temperature is 80 degrees, so right there. And the question is internal energy. So it becomes this one here, okay? Which is 333 something. Or we can use this approximation, UF at 80 degrees. Now, what is UF? What is UF? In this, in the compressed liquid tables, the first line for a given pressure gives the saturated liquid properties. So it is 1148.1. Okay. Let me see. Not pressure, not temperature. We don't have it here, so we will have to go to saturation temperature. Okay. To table 4. What is the temperature? 80 degrees. 80 degrees C. So UF right here. Okay, this is UF. 334.97. Okay. And the error involved is, if you compare, like points 3.34%. So 1/3 of 1% there. Okay. And this table shows again, gives some practice on finding properties. Okay. You can go through this at home. Okay, using your textbook there. Okay. Here the question is filling the missing properties here. That is calculating those properties, reading the properties if necessary, and completing this table here. So you will do, you know, some practice after this lecture. Okay, and you can follow the details from here. One question that needs to be answered is reference state. That is, we have numerical values there. What is the reference? Okay, it is not zero Kelvin, because if it is that way, the numbers will be huge. So to have reasonable values for water, usually we use 0.01, the triple point, as the reference point. And for the refrigerant, we use the minus 40, okay, as the reference point. Therefore, let's say for water, the UF, for example, is assigned a value of zero, okay, at 0.01. For refrigerant, HF is assigned a value of zero at minus 40. So if let's say you look at other tables in other books or references and you see different values, the reason is the reference temperature, okay? So you don't have to use minus 40, but it is convenient and it is common. So this is the most important part of this chapter, the properties of pure substances and how to read properties from tables. Any questions so far? Before we start gases. Okay, no question. Now, ideal gas. You have seen this so much that I will not spend you much time on ideal gas. It is basically PV is RT. Okay. And the basic idea is at low pressure and high temperatures, the pressure of a gas is proportional to temperature, inversely proportional to specific volume. Okay. And this is the constant of proportionality. So P is a constant times T over V, so PV is RT. This is the basic ideal gas equation of state. And R is, for any gas, the universal gas constant divided by the molecular mass of that gas. Okay. And this is the RU value. It is also in the tables there. That means, of these three properties, you know, if you know two properties, you can get the third one, okay? And you can also express it as PV is MRT by multiplying by mass. See, this is the basic equation, PV is RT. Or this is what? Universal gas constant times the number of moles, okay? You can express it that way. Or on a unit mass basis that way, or write it at two states, okay? Like P1 V1 is MRT1, P2 V2 is MRT2. Take the ratio. MRs will cancel for any substance and replace these. You will have P1 V1 over T1. Equal to P2 V2 over T2. Assuming, of course, mass is constant here. Okay. So a simple calculation you can go through. Now is water vapor an ideal gas? Okay, now let's get practical. To answer that question, what I did is I calculated the specific volume of water vapor at different pressures and temperatures, as you see here, okay? And then using ideal gas equation, and then compare them to the values listed at the tables. Okay? And comparing those two, I determine the error involved in the ideal gas relation. Now look at this region, low pressures. That is a pressure like, you know, maybe 100 kilopascal or here 50 kilopascal or something. In this region, look at the errors, 0%, 0.2%, 0.1%, 0.8%, you know. And these are, you know, low pressures and high temperatures, which means at sufficiently low pressures and high temperatures, the error involved in treating water vapor as an ideal gas is less than 1%. Okay, that means, let's say in air conditioning applications or the vapor in the air right now can be treated as an ideal gas. But if the pressures are high, like atmospheric pressure, 100 kilopascal, and you have all vapor, 1 megapascal, and the temperatures are low, like 200 degrees, you know, this region here, whatever. Or if you are around the critical point, as you see here, look at the errors. 271%, okay, 56%, 152%, whatever. In this area, obviously, the water vapor cannot be treated as an ideal gas. It will give a huge error. But as temperature rises, look at here, the error goes down. So at very high temperatures and reasonable pressures, okay, even like 5 megapascal and 600 degrees, the error is 2.4%. So in practice, what we do is, if you work with water vapor at high pressures, like in steam power plants, you never use ideal gas. But if, let's say, you deal with the water vapor in the air, okay, the pressure is low there, then you always use ideal gas. Okay, so it depends on the application there. And finally, if something cannot be treated as an ideal gas, is it possible to determine a correction factor and then use the ideal gas? Okay, the answer is yes. Now, this is what we have, right? PV is RT. Well, we can write it this way. PV is ZRT, okay? And call this Z a correction factor, which we call compressibility factor, okay? Compressibility factor. Obviously, Z can be greater than 1, equal to 1, less than 1. If it is equal to 1, that means it's an ideal gas, okay? And then if you can calculate Z, then we can calculate any property using this modified ideal gas equation of state. Now the question is, how can we calculate Z? Now, if you look at this chart, okay, if you define a reduced pressure as pressure relative to the critical pressure right here, and then reduce temperature as temperature divided by critical temperature, and we are using Kelvin here, okay? And pseudo-reduced specific volume like this, and plot the results. Plot the results for Z, okay? Now you see that for different reduced pressures, when PR is 1 and TR is 1, okay, which is this one here, this curve, as you see, you have the critical what point, okay, and for different values, let's say PR changes from 0 to 7 here, and for different TRs, you plot it. If, let's say, your PR is 3 and your TR is, let's say, 1.5, it is this curve, your z value is 0.8. So what you do is, given P and T, you calculate PR after reading the critical point pressure, and then calculate TR after reading critical point temperature in Kelvin, okay? And then you find PR and then TR from here, and you can read Z. In the appendix, we have a neat chart. We don't use this one. This is just to show that this process is true for different substances, okay? So that for all substances, we can use this compressibility chart. It simply shows that, okay? And if, let's say, specific volume is given, then you can determine PR and VR, and then you can calculate Z again in that chart. Okay. Example. We have refrigerant 134A at a given temperature and pressure. The question is, what is the error involved if you assume ideal gas? Now, we need to know for the error calculation, first of all, the properties of refrigerant 12 at the given temperature and pressure, okay? We also need the critical point properties. Therefore, we go to table 1 and we find the refrigerant 134A right here, okay? And we can read the critical point temperature, which is this one, and critical point pressure, okay? So we get those values from there. And then assuming ideal gas, we can calculate the specific volume as you see here. And then we don't know how accurate this is. To calculate PR and TR, we use the given pressure and temperature. Now we know PR and TR. And then we go to the table, I mean the chart, I don't have it here. It looks just like this. It is the compressibility chart there, okay, in the appendix. And then we read Z value of 0.84, okay? And then we calculate the specific volume from there. Now the error involved, I think that 2% is wrong there, okay? there's a typo there. The error involved is, I think about 20% right here. So this is how you use the chart, okay? If let's say you want to use the ideal gas, but in this course, you should know how to do this. But if it is an ideal gas, like, you know, air, nitrogen, whatever, we will just use the ideal gas. And if it is a steam and refrigerant, we will always use the tables. We will not bother with this. We will just, you know, because this is more difficult than reading the tables. Okay. And one word on other equations of state. Keep in mind that we have the ideal gas equation of state. But to make it more correct, we have the more complicated equations of state, like the van der Waals equation of state, okay? It accounts like the effect of the molecules as an added pressure and the volume occupied by the molecules at a reduction in volume, and gives the values of A and B to make it more accurate. Or another equation is, you know, more complex like this. Or even like Benedict Webb-Rubin, more complex equation, or generalized. These equations we will not use in this course. Okay, it is not worth it. Keep in mind that in the future, if you ever need equations of this kind, they exist. So I'll stop here. Now, do you have any questions on chapter 3? Okay, no questions. So I'll assume that you will do some reading at home and make sure that you feel comfortable with using tables and also understanding what ideal gas is, the correction factor, etc. So let's take another 5 minute or so break. And after the break, our assistant, Mehmet Can, he will do some examples for you. Okay? So I will see you next week.